Hello and welcome to this special edition of NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen. I'm Kevin Ochsner. Thanks for joining us. For as long as cattlemen have been caring for cows, the lowest cost feed source has always been grass. For most cattlemen, high quality forage is critical not only to the nutrition and health of their herd, but also to the profitability of their operation. With strong calf prices, the stage is set for herd expansion. For most operations, long-term success will be built on forages rather than on grain or purchase feed. So today, we're going to focus on the steps you can take to improve and maximize your forage value with the expert insights from leading producers and from our friends at Dow AgroSciences. So let's begin by welcoming our panel today. Dave Owens is the portfolio marketing leader for Dow AgroSciences. Bill Topper is a cow-calf producer from Trigg Hollow Farm in Tennessee. Pat Birch is with us. He's a field scientist with Dow AgroSciences. And Sims Price is a cow-calf producer from the Price Ranch in Texas, winner of the National Environmental Stewardship Award. Gentlemen, welcome to the show and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
I want to begin, first of all, by getting just some general impressions about the industry. You talk to a lot of folks just like I do. And, you know, I sense a great sense of optimism in the beef cattle business. How about you, Dave?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we started at convention, I think, really last year, and continued on. You can just sense that things are really turning around, especially for our cow-calf operators. They're doing extremely well. Profitability is up. And with the global demand for beef skyrocketing, things are really set for a good long run.
Bill, what would you say?
Oh, absolutely. We have a lot of positive discussions alongside the road in the mornings when we're sipping our coffee about expanding our operations and, again, enhancing profitability.
Good. And Pat?
Yes, I think one of the biggest attributes that people are looking forward to this year is we've had such good moisture. We've had a great moisture this winter. Spring's a little slow to get here, but very optimistic about that.
And Sims, speaking of moisture, I know you have been through a number of years of drought.
Yes,
what's your sense relative to the state of the industry?
Well, with the cattle prices what they're at today, we're just all eager to keep expanding our herds. If we can just get a little bit of rain to help us along, it'll sure be easy to keep growing.
You know, last year when we were on the show, Dave, we talked a lot about the whole high prices of feed grains and the importance that you know, shown on forages. Now that we've seen those feed grains moderate, are forages still important, do you believe?
Oh, absolutely. We're really entering into a new age of forages. They've always been the lowest price method to produce feed for your cattle, and they're still going to be the lowest cost price. I mean, we're talking, on average, across the nation, 45 cents to 50 cents worth of forage to put on a pound of beef. That's very, very economical. And as you look at what those big grain prices did, they took a lot of grassland out of production. And in some states, as many as 1 million acres of grass went into grain. Mm-hmm. So with that transition, we're going to have a lot of folks that are going to be in a wonderful position to maximize returns and yields on the grass that they have left and take advantage of a smaller acre base. It's going to be the key to expansion, is a good forage base going forward.
And speaking of good forage base, Bill, I'd ask you, I understand you've started your operation relatively recently, but you've decided to base it and focus it around forage production. Tell us more about that.
Yeah, the reason why we did that, I mean, we started 3 years ago with this operation. It was basically a renovation startup approach to cow-calf in southern Tennessee. And the approach that we pursued was because it allowed us to have a broader scope of variables that we could manage, if done correctly, could enhance profitability.
Bill, that's a great video and, more importantly, a fantastic story. Tell us more about what you've done to optimize forage production in your operation.
Well, I mean, as the videotape, you know, portrayed, it's been weed control, you know, ultimately it was number one for us for beginning. And now it's increasing the seed volume that we have of the grasses and legumes to enhance the pH level in our acreage without adding fertilizers and that sort of thing. But weed control will always be predominant for us. I mean, we have to have volumes of forage. And then it's working on the protein level that those volumes inhibit. Mm. That's critical for us.
Tell us more about some of the challenges that you've faced as you've tried to rebuild this this operation.
Well, you know, Mother Nature's number one. I mean, we obviously don't have any control over that. So what we have to take into consideration are the temperatures and the amount of precipitation that we get. You know, so our conservation program is really centered around managing those variables best we can. We try to contain our water, you know, rather than let it just run off the place into the nearby creek. That's number one. And number two is we just, again, keep increasing forage on every acreage that's available on the farm. And then we have to consider north-facing hills, south-facing hills. Different situations require a different recipe, you know, when it comes to different weeds that we have to treat or different seeds that will grow in those environments.
Sims, let's head south to Texas. I know the cattle operation is critically important, but you also run a big hunting business as well.
Yes, sir.
Tell us how you manage grazing for both your livestock as well as your wildlife.
We're in a rotational grazing system with being one herd, and we rotate those livestock around in a pasture at one time. By doing this, this allows the pastures to grow and recover and benefit from the cattle and sheep moving through. When they do this, then the deer and the turkey and the quail are allowed to be left with cover, and they can stay in these pastures instead of having to move away from the livestock. One of the things we have to do is to make sure that we have water available in all the pastures at all times, regardless of where the livestock are, so that they can stay at home.
What would you consider some of the key best practices that you've used to optimize production and grazing for all these livestock?
Again, rotational grazing is the key factor to our operation. Without it, it'd be hard to find the balance between them. Our brush management is another key aspect. We have to make sure that the rancher in us doesn't take and clear out all of the land and not leave any cover for the wildlife. So we have to remind ourselves that we're also in the wildlife business a little bit too.
Mm-hmm. That's very good. And you guys have been doing this for what, 5 generations? Is that
yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Outstanding. Well, we're going to have much more discussion about the best practices in pasture and rangeland management. But if you'd like more information about improving your forage, Dow AgriSciences, or any of our discussion topics today, you can always visit the website rangeandpasture.com.